Lord says it's time for preparing for the battle. So the battle's here. In your heart, in your mind. See, the devil's going to attack your body, your family, your finances. But he says, what you give up, he takes. What you possess is your spirit. He says, those things in the spirit will shift, and those who follow my spirit will be safe. He said, my cloud protected them. My cloud protected them. My cloud protects them. This is the season, the Lord says. Open your eyes. Open your spiritual eyes. Your spiritual heart. He says, don't look on the outside anymore. Shift. Move. Be under the cloud. Because it is a time of battle. There's protection in the spirit. In the mighty name of Yeshua. Amen. All right. A little drunk in the spirit. That's good. That's always good. We were in worship. And... in front of the, in England, the Buckingham Palace, they have the guards. How many people have ever seen those guys? And they're trained to stand there. I don't know if it's 8, 10, 12 hours. They're supposed to stand there. And they're not supposed to flinch. And they have people come up before them throwing garbage at them. And I mean, they got every whack job in the planet trying to make them come off base. You know? And the ministry is kind of like that, because we're here, we're supposed to have that face of flint. We're supposed to be able to stand here, and whatever's coming at us demonically, whatever, we need to reject it. And these guys literally have to clear their minds, and they stand there in battle with the forces, the weather, and they're not supposed to lose their post. They're not supposed to leave their spot. And I see that happening with the church. It's too much. And my feet hurt. The problem right now with the church, people don't know what your jobs are. And the jobs start in the spirit. And those things in the spirit, you have to start recognizing. That battle we're in, constant battle. There's a constant battle going on. And we're supposed to stand there and guard. And the question the Lord was showing me for you guys tonight, what are you guarding? Most of us try to guard our family. But there's a stewardship over our family people aren't even taking care of anymore. I mean, how many ever seen a bachelor's house? Been there, seen that. You know, there's certain standards. I was talking to Wyman, and Wyman's getting ready to get married, so he has to stop being a bachelor. He has to start thinking about cleaning dishes, picking up his clothes, those kind of things, you know. But we have that same issue in the church system. We're supposed to be shifting away from what's in the world to what we're supposed to be doing. And we should be standing guard at all times, being ready to do what the Lord tells us. And when we get into worship, this week's been a testing week for a lot of people. We started getting into worship, and the Lord told us, no more, there's no more time for preparation. We're in battle. This is the last Shabbat of August. Anybody who's been clock watching, you know, Jonathan Collin was talking about the Shemitah, and you know, we took Mark Biltz to Korea, and we're not forecasting anything bad. We're preparing for the devil to come at us with everything he got. Now, his timing, I don't know when. But the understanding of the time frames we're in is the most important thing. And the Lord keeps showing me that he's attacking the church. He's attacking the people in the church. Not only our church, but many churches at the point of the Spirit. And to do that, it's almost like that Buckingham Palace that he's trying to get your focus away from your position. And every guard there has the same job, even though they're different people. And we have people in here, as Pastor Kimberly was doing the Sabbath, she was talking about carrying the ark. We need more people helping. I mean, it looks small here, but I know we got another service going in the kids' room. It's booming over there. And I appreciate that, because it's the next generation has to be prepared. And if they're not taught to battle, I don't know who's going to battle. Let's turn to Deuteronomy. And we're almost done with the book of Deuteronomy. And the book of Deuteronomy prepares. We're in the Kitetze. The book of Deuteronomy prepares us to go into the promised land. And we see that we're in Deuteronomy 24. Don't throw rocks at me, guys. Wait, let's get into the reading and I'll explain what we're talking about. If you read Deuteronomy 24, it throws some heavy-duty legal stuff at you. And let's look at Deuteronomy 24, verse 4, the second half, where it says, "And you shall not bring sin on the land which your Lord God gives you as an inheritance." Okay, don't read the first part of that. Okay? And I'm going to explain why. It says, "And you shall not cause the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to sin." What we start dealing with is a situation of covenant and relationship. Covenant and relationship. And in the Moses was given a right of divorce to the woman because of the man's hard heart. And so that divorce was to protect the woman. And if you read that whole, you start going through Deuteronomy 24, you'll start seeing that there's covenant-breaking people that break covenants at different levels. And the way we do that now is by introducing new gods, or going back to old gods, or playing around with wrong spirits, witchcraft. All this stuff they were dealing with in the wilderness. Moses was seeing this problem, and the Lord spoke to him about the husband-wife relationship, and it has to do with the same thing with the church. It says, well, if you divorce a woman and then she goes to another man, then you can't marry if it comes back. The whole thing was that they didn't want wife swapping. And that the women, at one level, that they were given property rights through the Hebrew. And you see one of the issues that a lot of the folks don't realize, that the Christians / Hebrew, the Judeo-Hebrew people, have always given women property rights. You don't see that in any other countries. But what we start seeing here is that there's a breaking of the covenant and the people with each other first, and then it builds into the relationship to the community. It goes from the family to the community to the state. And we start asking ourselves questions. Let's go to Deuteronomy 24:19. Let's hit that first before I hit the question. Deuteronomy 24:19. "When you reap your harvest in your field and have forgotten a sheaf in the field, you shall not go back and get it. It should be for the alien, the orphan, and the widow, in order that the Lord God may bless you in the work of your hands." We see that same scripture in the New Testament where it talks about true ministry is widows and orphans. It should say alien there too. But what happens in the New Testament, the aliens, the non-believers, the nations, come into the nation through Christ. Now, at that same time, when they were in the desert, a third of the people that came out of Egypt were the Egyptians, and they had to acclimate themselves to the Hebrew culture. Those things that we start seeing, that there's a property right, but there's also a way to handle the property. And that there's a bonus and there's a blessing the way you handle the property, and it has to do with stewardship. Stewardship. And we can fast forward this, that the stewardship starts in your homes, with your families, with your kids. We got 4-year-old kids memorizing the Bibles, the entire books of the Bibles. We have kids praying in the Spirit, and I'm arguing with people that they need to pray in the Spirit, and it's like, why the kids can pick it up. So some of the basic stuff we need to have in the church that we should be prepared for, we're not ready yet. So there's a testing of the Spirit right now that the Lord's dealing with a lot of people, and that stewardship is connected to your citizenship. Your citizenship. So the book of Deuteronomy is preparing this new generation or the next generation to go into the promised land based on a stewardship that's connected to their citizenship in heaven. Has to be that way. And we have this diluted gospel right now where people are bringing in whatever they want, multiple cultures. That's why we're blessed. How many cultures we have here? Like 10, 12 different cultures. And we have people from, we got other Rhema graduates in here. We got other ORU. We got a bunch of high-end Bible people. But the bottom line is we're here to submit to the Holy Spirit. And the end time battle will be submission to the Holy Spirit. And that those other gods that were tempting them in the desert are coming back. And we see that in pride and in their cultures that they have. So we're still talking about the falling away. We're dealing with the falling away with the measure of faith last week. How much measure of faith? And more I study, the more I'm seeing that the culture of the Christian culture, we have an apostolic state and an apostate. I was driving down the street yesterday and the Lord spoke to me. I'm looking at, and there's a lot of churches that don't have pastors. Did you know that? There's churches without pastors. And I asked the Lord, how do they function without a shepherd? And he said, they're apostate. They're based on a system. They're not based on God's leadership or authority. They're based on a system, like a country club almost. But the members are voting the pastors out. It's terrible. It's an apostate church. And these are big churches, little churches, and there's people that go there, and it's literally like sheep going in for water and food, and there's nothing there. It's serious. So this is the time that we got to wake up as a church, a community, a church system, and we have to understand that this falling away in this season is connected to your citizenship. We're not going to build any fences. You know, it's funny because a lot of the arguments we hear about in politics, let me tell you something. The arguments you're hearing in politics, they already have the answers. They just have to follow their own rules. We have the answers before us. It started off with the Ten Commandments and it expanded. It actually started off with Noah's seven laws, and before that, Adam had six. And before you know it, they took the Ten Commandments and turned it into 613 laws because people kept twisting things and saying, well, that should be right. Look how righteous I am. I'm following the law. But the law is not based on legalism. The base law, Torah, is based on relationship. God's teaching you how to move in the direction you're supposed to go, when you're supposed to be there, and how to act. So Torah specifically doesn't mean law. That's been polluted. When things are translated, you hear in different languages, I can use, there's different, my name, Carl, in Korean means sword. Kal. You know, over here it doesn't mean that. This, it means house cleaning, dish cleaning, go shopping cleaning, is my laundry done? Honey, I'm home. Wiley's dad. So the citizenship that we deal with is not based on a legalism of the Bible. It's based on a relationship of the Bible. And so when Christ came and he said, well, I completed the law, he didn't say, I'm here to complete the laws. He says, I'm here to develop a relationship. Because what was missing was the relationship with the Mashiach. That they had the Word of God, they had a understanding that the Messiah was coming. When he came, he left, and he brought us the Holy Spirit. So what you see in the desert, the cloud, the seven spirits of God that were operating in unison in the desert over the populace, protected them. The Holy Spirit's with us, and the attributes of God are all connected to the Holy Spirit. I was off the other day, and the Jehovah Witnesses came by. Oh, my favorite people. And they got the little Bible and everything. And, you know, my wife has seen me chase them down the street. I stay on my property line. I know these things. And they're really nice people. And I tell them, you know, when you go to hell, you're going to call me? And so we start this real, well, we want to show you my book. I said, well, you want to show me in your book? You got 125 transliterated errors and issues in your Bible. Why would I look at that piece of garbage? And I said, by the way, King James was a homosexual, and it's not the Bible you have right now. It's not based on anything other than propaganda. And see, they don't realize when you start asking them questions like, oh, they don't believe that Jesus came in the flesh, that he was an angel. It's like, doesn't the Bible say to test the spirits? And those spirits, they won't admit that Jesus came in the flesh. They won't say that. And I start telling them, I go, how can I argue with you when you got demons? And, you know, of course I had to put in the fact that Michael Jackson and French were both Jehovah's Witnesses. And there's no J's in Hebrew. And so I told them, stop using my God's name in vain. And they don't like that. And they want, well, let's come in and talk. I go, I don't want your dirty spirits brought into the house. I'm not going to do that. Have you ever seen me act like this? Often? Yes, okay. So, you know, I'm not trying to be incorrigible, but we have to guard what we have as clean and pure and wholesome. And we were in worship, and the Lord was showing me that we got to turn the darkness off. We got to turn it off. Because we have too much darkness coming in, and even through the media, and you know, we have to pray for things, but I'll tell you what, there's just so much garbage. I'm almost to the point where I got to divorce my phone. All right. But so let's go to the teaching today. The following way, does God know you? Does God know you? And let's go to Galatians 4:9. And we got into worship and went a little bit long. They ate all the macaroni and cheese. Praise God. I forgot meatballs. I don't know how that happened. First time in 6 years, 7 years, no meatballs. Galatians 4:9. But now that you have come to know God, hold on, rather to be known by God, how is it that you turn your back again to the weak and worthless elementary things to which you desire to be enslaved all over again? Can we take that and stick it back in Moses' mouth? And Moses is sitting there and saying, look, why are you guys going backwards? We just got you out of Egypt. There was an entanglement, there was a slavery there, and people don't realize it. That this is happening again in our country in a subtle manner, in a PC matter. And PC is not for por Cristo. Si como no? Por Cristo? No. That's Spanish for Christ, right? I just made that up. PC. Okay, that didn't work. You are known by God based on the covenant that he established through the Holy Spirit that he's given you and the actions that you're following and being recognized by. You follow the whole book of Galatians, the rest of that chapter, and get into chapter 5. It starts talking about the fruits of the Spirit. Let's go to Galatians 4:10 and through 12. It says, you observe the days and the months and the seasons and the years. I fear for you that perhaps I have labored over you in vain. Verse 12, I beg of you, brethren, because I am, for I also have become as you are, you have done me no wrong. There are people that come into the Messianic and they start celebrating the feasts and the festivals, and they forget about Christ. They forget about the Messiah. They forget about the priority. The times and the holidays are just the schedule that we follow, and we see things coming up prophetically. We were talking about this Jubilee coming up. It's the 70th Jubilee, which is 70 times 50 is 3,500. 3,500 years since Moses got what? The Ten Commandments. This is a big celebration coming up. It's a generation of a man, 70 years. So the gospel plus the handling of the holidays properly with no religious problems, trying to put some kind of religious connection on it, needs to have the relationship with the Holy Spirit. Harvey Diamond, that used to be here, Harvey had an excellent page on his website that showed the holidays, and each holiday there are seven different attributes of relationship that needs to come with the holidays. And these holidays are all expressed in the New Testament. You just have to look for them. You have to understand what you're looking for. Well, what is it pointed out? Well, most of the people that were already reading these things or understood them, they were following that, so they were already in sync with the holidays. They weren't arguing about the holidays. Well, it says they got rid of the holidays here, they got rid of the holidays here. No, no. I was talking to a gentleman today, has a deliverance ministry, and we brought up your friend T.B. Joshua. And he was amazed how T.B. Joshua picked up the fact that without the Ten Commandments, understanding the Shabbat, there could not be full deliverance. Sincerely. A lot of people are understanding, like, wow, that's really heavy duty. But you have to understand the early church was already on that cycle. So when the people were coming in, there was an acclimation of the early church, the believers of Israel, and then there was also a shifting. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 1 through 3. And we're going to show something. So in Galatians 4:9, he was talking to the early church, specifically to the Hebrew believers in that place. 1 Corinthians 8:1-3. Now concerning things, food, sacrifice to idols, we know that we are all have knowledge, and knowledge makes arrogance, but love edifies. If anyone supposes that he knows anything, he has not yet known as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by him. There's a shifting back to the Gentiles in that acclimation process, that God brought the Gentiles in and that they had to release their idol worship. Same way that the Hebrew believers had to release the understanding or the religious spirit they had over their holidays. They had the feast functioning, but with a religious spirit on top, and it was quashing the spirit. It was hurting the essence, the spirit of the holidays. And so Paul was dealing with the people in the Corinthian church, that the acclimated non-Hebrews that were coming into the church system had to give up their stuff. We all see that? So the Hebrew believers that came out of Israel had to shift towards the center, towards Christ, and the Gentile believers had to give up their idol worship, and they had to shift towards the middle, towards Christ. This is a purpose of everybody has to shift. You have to find yourself in Christ and the relationship you have with Christ. Move towards that center spot that God wants you. So it goes back to what God spoke to them. He says, God knows you by the love you have for him. For him. It has nothing to do with how pious you are, how religious you are, how knowledgeable you are. None of that. None of it. He breaks it down right there. He breaks it down where he takes away all the arguments of everybody that comes in that holds themselves up higher in authority than the Spirit of God or the canon of the Scripture. And you see that they had mixed idols. You had the Greeks, you had the Romans. Well, the Greeks call them Zeus. Over here, they call them Apollos. They have all these different names that they're trying to blend in. They bring it in. Eventually, it ends up in the Catholic Church. It does. But the early church had power. Where's the power come from? The power comes from a love relationship that you have with God and the Holy Spirit. Now, we got some young single men. I was complimenting you, Wyman. Young single men have to learn to clean their house. Clean dishes. Vacuum iron. Mow the yard. Fix the car. Program the computer. Right? You do all of those. You're a man's man. But we really need that back in the church. We have to get people functioning in relationships, and that not everything's hyper-spiritual. Well, you know, some things you have to learn by the Spirit. Yes, but you have to yield to the Spirit. You have to make an effort to be in the right place to receive. If you don't, there's going to be a relationship issue. Let's go back to Matthew, and we've read this many a time. Matthew 7:16. Matthew 7:16. And Jesus addresses this to his disciples, 7:16-23. And it goes back. It says, beware of false prophets. No, we'll start at 15. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. There's a lot of people in the church systems don't realize they're wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit. The bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. This is getting rough. So then, you'll know them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Let's start over. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven, many will say to me on the day, Lord, Lord, did not we prophesy in your name, or in your name cast out demons, in your name perform many miracles? And then I declared to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. We see this behavior, attitude of the good tree. Behavior, good attitude, but the love of God. You also start seeing this relationship situation based on your salvation. And that salvation is not dependent on work or religion, but on relationship. And you keep breaking this down, you start seeing that they're spiritually operating in gifts. They're spiritually in the spirit realm, using the name of Jesus, Yeshua, and trying to cast out demons. They're trying to do these things, but at the end, he goes, hey, I don't know you. That's like somebody stealing your credit card and trying to use your credit card and rack up, hey, look what I did. And they said, no, I didn't give you that authority, because there's no love relationship there. Verses 22-23, it says, in the end time, the missing the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the main contact that we have with God right now, will cause this. And there's a lot of arguments about the Holy Spirit right now. Now, if you talk to the Jehovah's Witnesses, they don't recognize it. They say Jesus was an angel. Ooh. Didn't you see a halo on his head? Remember that picture David sent me with the halo I had on my head? It was a light. Well, look at the halo. But these are other gods. Anybody know where the origins of halos come from? In the Greek mythology, the gods had the planets going around their heads. They used to Saturn, the rings. That's where that comes from. There's no word halo in the Bible. You didn't know that? Go look it up. But we have this end time dilemma where we're not following the Holy Spirit. We're trying to use psychology against God. It's like Kimberly was saying, we're trying to shove God in a box and it's not going to work. So we're spending all of our energy fighting God when God says, don't fight me. Follow me. Follow the Spirit of God. Be under the Spirit of God. Be in the Spirit, with the Spirit. So everything we talk about, we see this the Spirit man choice. Does he know you by the Spirit? What Spirit are you operating in? And that Spirit's tied to your attitude. Well, you know, we've been talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit a lot lately. And I'm going to tell you, we've lost some folks over it. I'm going to tell you this. Let's put it this way. The Great Commission talks about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit, every person who wrote in the New Testament was baptized in the Spirit, prayed in the Spirit, period. So if you don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, do not read the New Testament. Every person that wrote in the New Testament was baptized in the Spirit of God. Period. Is that true? All right. I like that. Secondly, if you are not receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there's a yielding or understanding that the Holy Spirit that's inside you wants to come out. And that yielding isn't a stopping of your brakes. You stop at stop signs, right? But when the sign says yield, you merge with it. You have to initiate and maintain a relationship with the Holy Spirit. And it's just not a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And the reason why I'm saying this, the Lord was showing me, how many people used to play in the sandbox when you were a kid? Okay, remember you take that magnet and you stick the magnet in there and you pull it out and there's all the metal filings. How many people had that? All right, well, my cousins. Either. But that's kind of the way it's going to be when Christ comes back. It's going to be by the recognition of the Holy Spirit inside you to bring us out. And that the apostate church, ooh, I'm gonna ruin some people's time, and I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes. The apostate church is functioning without the Holy Spirit. They're actually grieving the Spirit of God because they're recognizing certain things in the New Testament, but they're refusing to recognize the fullness of the Holy Spirit. So do you see these people that say, I don't believe in that, or that was for that time, wrong. They're cheating and they're shortchanging the body of Christ. And the fullness of the church cannot happen without the Holy Spirit. Period. I don't care if it's Billy Graham, Billy Brim, or Billy Holiday. Anybody knows Billy Holiday? Oh, there you go. I got one. The oldest man in the church. Praise God. The Jewish guy knew. See, the Jews are the smartest people, right, David? Yeah, he's back there shaking his head. The Holy Spirit has to be with you at all times. This is what's going to differentiate us. Why is so? He's the main contact we have with God. If you don't pray in the Spirit, this is why we got the people praying in the Spirit. If you're not praying in the Spirit, how do you discern what you're supposed to do? Remember 911? How many people? There were supposed to be 50,000 people in those two buildings. 50,000 people in those two buildings. Story after story after story, people were like, well, I was trying to do this and I was led away. Something happened. Something drew them away. How many stories have you heard like that? I pray for you to have that kind of discernment where God doesn't have to crash your car and you get in a fight someplace so you're going to be traumatized someplace else or killed. I've heard stories. I was backing out of my car and the garbage can hit. It's just stupid things that God used to keep people alive. We're coming into a situation where we got the Jubilees coming up. You got the Shemitah. All this stuff about ready to hit the fan. Can we say that, fan? Yeah. All right. How many tall guys we got here? How many times do you ever take off your shirt and the fan was going? Yeah, oh man, there goes your fingers. Ah, jeez. Let's turn to Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. I'm going to run through this real quick because I want to make some points, but I got to build up, put some ammunition in you. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. God created you with a purpose. We've talked about this a dozen times. When you were created, when you were born through your mother's sin gate, when you were birthed into this planet, you lost your destination. I do not believe in predestination, but what happens when you get born again, he starts lining you back up, and when you get the Spirit of God, he gets you back on track with your original purpose that he made you to do. He made you for this time. He made you with the power of God. He made you with a gift. He made you with a discernment. He made you with those things that you have, but you got to learn to use them and when to use them. It's not being predestinated, predestined. I don't believe in predestination. Except the only thing that's predestiny, predestined, is if you don't accept Yeshua, you go to hell. How do you like that? You want to hear my definition of grace? If you're alive, that's grace. Because only the devil can't kill you. God's protecting you. If you're alive, you're under grace, guys. Has nothing to do with Jesus or salvation or preaching death. A gospel of grace. How many people heard the gospel of grace? I still haven't found it in the New Testament. I like that thing I put on the Facebook about Noah's Ark. That he didn't build the ark by grace, he did it by works. Certain things you have to work out. You have to work out your salvation. So let's turn to Psalms 139. And so he knew you before you were born in the womb. At what point do you actually know God? People talk about God all the time, and that God has a relationship with you, but he doesn't know you until you have a relationship with him. Well, this sounds real basic, but I'll tell you what, the Lord's telling me that we need to start all over, because we're in a time of Teshuvah, the month of Elul, which is a time of repentance. And if you hung around with Kimberly all day long, you'd be repenting all day long. You're not my Holy Ghost, honey. Actually, we pray in different rooms. It's funny because we always come up with the same stuff. I think she prays. I pray louder than her, so she's like. Psalm 139, 1 through 14. And it says, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Where? Right there. This is after he was born. So God's comparing you to the original project he started. And did you take your life, and are you gearing your life back into shape to fit his plan? So he knew you. Thou knows when I sit down and when I rise up. Thou understand my thought from afar. Thou scrutinize my path, my lying down, my art intimately acquainted with all my ways, even before there is a word on my tongue. Behold, O Lord, thou know it all. Thou says, enclose me behind and before, and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. Hey, some of those plans he has for you, you don't want. It's going to be a challenge. You're going to have to give up some of your garbage there. It is too high, I cannot attain it. But he knows what you're made out of. He made you. Verse 7, where can I go from thy spirit? Whoa. This is where it starts hitting the road. The rubber meets the road is the spirit. Well, where can I flee from thy presence, which is the spirit? I can ascend to heaven, thou art there. I can make my bed in Sheol. Behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the dawn and I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even where thy hand will lead me, and at the right hand lay down and hold me. If I say, surely the darkness will overwhelm me, the light around me will be night. Verse 12, even the darkness is too dark thee, and it, night is bright as day, darkness is light, alike to thee. For thou didst form my inner parts. Listen to this. Thou didst weave me in my mother's womb. I give thanks to thee. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are thy works, and my soul knows it very well. We have a battle between your mind, your body, your purpose, and the spirit. Your spirit man was created in the image of God's Holy Spirit. This is why we need the mind of the Father, the Word of God. Well, the Jews don't believe in the triune God. Well, technically, no, because they believe in the spirit, mind, and body, represented as the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And He has our mind that we want to conform our mind to the Word of God. Certain things in our body, we got to crucify the flesh, as Christ did. But with the Holy Spirit, there has to be an intimacy going back and forth between the Holy Spirit. Your Holy Spirit has to yield to the purpose of God, so He knows you. He knows you. He knows what you're doing anyway. It's terrible. But that's what, earlier in the prophecy, I forgot I read this earlier today, the Lord was showing me that we have to turn the darkness off. How do you turn the darkness off? Bring the light in. Where's the light? Inside you, in your mouth, in your attitude, your will. You have the power to do that, where Jesus says, no, I do know you. Come closer to me. What's the opposite of get away from me, I don't know you? Hey, I know you, come over here. Pastor Kimberly says this all the time, God loves you uniquely, not equally. Well, God loves everybody. Yeah, He does. Uniquely, not equally. Well, what do you mean? He hated Esau. Esau rejected God. And what we've been teaching and reading, that it has to do with the connection you have with God in your love affair with God and loving your life. Well, this is hard. This is hard. Well, you got to get around some people that are going to build you up. And the church has been emaciated, starved to death, because there's no power, no word, and no action. And the end time church may be a smaller group of people, but it's going to be a powerhouse because you guys were all night in a fire. Praise God. He created you, and you're not supposed to hide from the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the main interaction that God gave us to interact with God. Why is that? Well, Jesus is up there on the throne. Holy Spirit created you. He created everything here. Why are we talking about the Holy Spirit? Because the Holy Spirit dominated the world. God made the world, made us in His image, actually made Adam in the image of Yeshua, had authority, which He dropped, brought back the Bible, the Torah, gave us instruction, made a covenant with Abraham, and sent His Son to reorganize us and put us back on track. It sounds complicated, but it's simple. It's complicated when you bring in all these other origins and all this other confusion into the body of Christ. You have to take your attitude and those things that you are dealing with out of place. It's like, you know, cell phones. They can cause a lot of problems. They're useful, but they shouldn't be dominating us. We got to turn the light on. We got to get the worship music on. We got to get these things in your household. You got to tell your kids no. You got to tell your husband no. You got to tell your wife no, in a good way. Once. You got one chance, guys. Let's go to Ephesians. Right, Ramesses? Yeah, one time. Run for us. Ephesians. Ephesians 1:13. In Him. Okay. Okay, let's Okay, in that word there, in him, it's capitalized, right? How many Rhema students out there? Is him is Christ or him the Holy Spirit? In him, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, also, or having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit of promise. So in him, we understand we have the covenant that we operate in him. But we're sealed in the Spirit with the Holy Spirit, which is the essence of Christ. They're all connected. You can't separate them. You can't separate them. And that's where you get the Jesus only folks. Have you, anybody know what Jesus only is? They believe Jesus, when he was here, was the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all at one time. That means that Jesus was a schizophrenic ventriloquist. He was speaking to himself. Seriously. But we have to understand that there is a triune part of God, but we cannot fit everything in there. And we see that word in the Shema, Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, plural pronoun, team. Team. Like the Dallas Cowboys. Well, how many people are on the Dallas Cowboys? There's a lot of components. It's a team. Usually the term triune is not in the Bible, but that's the description we use. He seals us with a promise. Where's that promise come from? Before the foundation. When he created you, he gave you a promise. Hey, you know, this is your game plan. This is what you're supposed to do. Grow up, get Jesus, find a nice wife, clean up your house, be a good citizen. Seriously. And the body of Christ is confused right now. Thank God it's the end of the time. We can't fall apart anymore than we are. Sealed with the promise, can we lose that promise? Can we break covenant with the Holy Spirit? Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22. Let's start with verse 21. 21 and 22. Now he who establishes us with you in Christ and anointed us in God, who also sealed us, gave us the Spirit in the hearts as a pledge. You get the Holy Spirit, you accept Christ, he is the Messiah, he's the Mashiach, he's the creator of the heavens and the earth, and you get the Holy Spirit who seals you with a promise. This goes beyond anything that any man can teach you. It's beyond anything that you can reason. It's all in the Spirit, because the relationship you have is you're engulfed in the Holy Spirit. And what we do, we puncture holes, we try to get out of the Holy Spirit, and we do that with our mind. We reject the Holy Spirit, reject the principles of God, we reject the Creator, and we bring in other gods and other idols. This is the issue in the church system, and people don't want to use it. It's like voting. If you vote for the wrong person and they turn out to be lied to you, you're still held accountable. You got to repent. You got to go back. And this is what Teshuvah is doing. Teshuvah, well, you made a mistake over here. Well, you go back here and start all over. You literally have to start all over. And when we're talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we got a lot of people that have a limited gift of tongues. You know what? Let's go back to the beginning, repent, and give me the full language. I want everything that God has for me beyond what we see right now. The church system, the messianic. I was talking to a pastor today. You know, somebody left some water up here. I was talking to a pastor today, and he was dealing with one of our members about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he's telling, this guy's going out, have you received the Holy Spirit? Oh, receive the Holy Spirit. But there's no evidence of speaking in the Spirit and speaking in tongues. Well, think about the transition of the Hebrew people, the Hebrew culture in the early church Everybody was waiting for the Messiah. Jesus dies on the cross. He's resurrected. The Holy Spirit comes down. The phenomenon of the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes to 110, 120 people in the upper room after he breathed on them in John 20, 22. He breathes on them, and what happens? There's a manifestation of the Spirit of God. We need that. That's the end time. We need the manifestation of the Spirit of God around us where we're completely enclosed by the Spirit. The other thing that the Lord is showing me about 2 Corinthians 1:22, there's an ownership by the Spirit. That ownership by the Spirit, he doesn't own you until you accept him. It's not slavery. You are not going to be Holy Ghost possessed. You have to yield in a relationship like you would to your spouse or your husband. And that yielding to the Spirit of God gives you that power and the empowerment where he knows you, because when you accept that, there's a pledge he's already made to your spiritual inheritance. There's a pledge that he's already promised you. He's pledged this, that this will happen when you do this. Takes it up a whole different level. We've taken the Holy Spirit for granted too long. He is the action powerhouse of the triune Godhead. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. We're doing good right now. I'm going to wrap it up here in a minute. Ephesians chapter 4, 30 through 32. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. This is how he's going to know who to bring up. I don't care if you're thinking pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib, multiple tribs. He's looking for you being sealed in the Spirit. If you don't have this, it's not going to count. Is that true? Right there. I'm not making it up. Let all bitterness, wrath, and anger, and clamor, slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Whoa! Here comes Teshuvah. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also forgiven you. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. We say that, well, that was for back then. Oh, the gifts of the Spirit, those are for back. That was for the early church. That was for that apostle guy. You just grieve the Holy Spirit. He created you before the foundation with a powerful destiny. Not predestined, but a destiny. An inheritance that you can step into and build up as you walk in love with him, being encouraged by the Spirit. That power only comes when you tune into the Spirit of God. So you don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. Let's turn to 1 Thessalonians 5:19. People don't want to hear this because they want to hang on. Let's start with verse 16. 1 Thessalonians 5:16. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ. I can handle that. Do not quench the Spirit of God. Do not despise prophetic utterance, but examine everything carefully. Hold on to the fast, that which is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Wow. You literally quench the Spirit. You're cutting him off. You're basically, talk to the hand. You don't want to, you really cut him off. You're quenching the Spirit. You're cutting off the Spirit of God. How many denominations right now are, well, you know that homosexual marriage is okay as long as they're doing it, but they can come in our church, but we're not going to object to it. Oh, yeah, you know what? We voted for these people who booed God, and they're killing 2,100 babies a day, but you know what? They're good people. Come on. What we're going to see, literally, judgment, judgment. If we don't shift away, and if you've grieved the Holy Spirit, you know what? We talked about this. Repent, talk to him, ask him for forgiveness. I mean, you can blaspheme everything, but don't blaspheme the Holy Spirit. How many people saw that with Planned Parenthood, where the Satanists are having milk baptisms in front of the Planned Parenthood? Has anybody seen that? That's disgusting. You know how we get water baptisms? They're going in front of Planned Parenthood because of bloodshed inside there. The death of baby. They're in there worshiping that. And you know what? These kids grew up in a Christian country. No wonder why the Russians are looking at us like a bunch of idiots. The Russians, the Vladimir Putin, he's saying that we're, that his country is a Christian country, not United States. This is crazy stuff. And we're grieving the Holy Spirit every time we take an opinion above the Bible, outside the Bible. Anytime we criticize the Bible, we're in disbelief in the Bible. We're not discerning the Holy Spirit. We're mocking salvation. We're mocking pastors. We're criticizing pastors. There's a lot of pastors out there that have a piece of the truth. And we do not want to mock them. There's some bad pastors out there too. And there's people with many gifts. Those folks with gifts, don't criticize them. Because what happened at some point in time, they went astray. Girl, gold, glory. Some kind of powerhouse trip that they came in and they fell apart. And that's why it's I see the struggle in the church system, because many people came into the church system from a poverty level, and they see the church system as some way of climbing some social ladder and maintaining a status in the community. I was talking to one young man, he goes, well, what kind of pastor are you? He goes, I'm going to be a rich pastor. Well, really? Well, go get a job. But this time, it's all about the Holy Spirit. He is the one that Christ will be looking for in you. He is going to be looking where you're at. This is where the power comes in. This is where the unity comes in one spirit, one baptism, one Bible. Those things that he's going to judge us on, it doesn't matter how old you are, how young you are, your background, male, female, country, origin, anything. Equal in Christ. That Spirit of God, he created you. We all have choices. I see people with bitter stuff going on, little issues. That's why these Hebrew holidays are important, because we have to examine ourselves. This is a time for teshuvah, repentance. Examine yourself. I mean, be honest. Well, you know, I'm losing a little hair. Oh, that's honest. Just be, find something to be honest with. Most of us are living in some kind of lie. Distorted life. And the church does not know how to deal with it, because we're dealing out of that emotion. We're dealing out of a soulish realm, and we're going around the Holy Spirit. We pray in the Spirit, in this church, that the Spirit of God starts moving. We want to see a revival. It has to be in the Spirit, because everything else is dead. Only way we can have a real revival is in the Spirit. Well, I don't believe in that. You know what? I just showed you scripture saying, if you don't believe in that, you're in trouble. You're hurting the Holy Spirit. You're saying, well, I'm not quenching the Spirit, but I don't believe in that. You're lying. You can't have both things. There has to be a submission, complete submission to the Spirit of God, for him to ignite the power, those promises, everything that you have, those plans that he's put inside you to grow you up. Until you do that, you're going to struggle. And I see people battling in their minds, in their lives, in their marriages with their kids. And there's a double standard. Well, I don't want to push that on my kids until they get older and they can make a choice. Well, how did that turn out for you? Seriously. But we also have people that are quenching the Spirit of God, cutting them off. We're talking about this right now, everybody in here. I'm speaking to your spirit, man. I don't care about your brain saying. I don't care if your brain turned me off when I started speaking. I've been speaking into your spirit, man, from the beginning here. And if your spirit is at peace, praise God. You're on track. If your spirit's unrested, you need to change. It has nothing to do with me. That's the Spirit of God talking to you. And he's going to deal with you until you shift. Until you shift. Until you shift. You have to move towards him. Then he will say, I love you. Then he'll recognize who you are. Those times are coming, and the body of Christ has to wake up. Father, let your spirit move tonight. Line us up with your word, your true word. That any other spirit in this house been preaching another gospel, a false gospel, that's been coming against the mighty name of Yeshua, coming against the house of Yeshua, those things that have nothing to do with your name, your spirit, must leave. Everything else, Father, we ask for your provisions, your power, your plan in our lives, that we can pursue you and fulfill our destiny in you. Father, protect Yeshua House, grow us up, change our hearts, show us which direction to go, in the mighty name of Yeshua. Amen.